So, as a way of introduction, my name is Gary Welch. I am a political researcher and a strategist, and right now that really is like being insultive and everything. They really did a really bad job on this election. But saying that, I want to say that I'm very unconventional. So if you came to me and you asked me typical questions about how do we do this in campaigns and all the do that stuff, my answers would probably not be the same that a typical political researcher or strategist would tell you. So I actually consider myself a constitutional political guerrilla fighter, because I think that we have to take the fight in a little bit different way. We're going to have to act differently. So one of the things that kind of portrays this is here I am talking to you. In the meantime, I've got one of my little guerrilla fighters in the back there. Raise your hand, Valerie. See, she's got her little hat on. You didn't even know that, and I snuck her in on you. And that's exactly what we're going to do. So, one of the things that I am never going to do, I do want to be very much a part of this party, and I want to be there. But one of the things that I'm never going to do is be a candidate. And I'm not going to probably even be an officer, and I'll tell you why. And that's because the reason why I'm a researcher is my father always taught me to say how I felt and just put it out there. So Daryl's very, very eloquent, and he knows how to coach things. I don't. So where's our little Republican friend? Did he leave?
Yeah.
Good. You're now going to see why I cannot be a candidate. So I have one question for him. Maybe he can watch this or get the transcripts, or you guys can tell him. What's he on the fence about? Let me give you a little background of how I got here. I was a researcher for doing local stuff for the local Republican Party in Washington State. I just had the luck, I guess you would, of a good campaign manager take me under his wing. He saw that what we were doing was really, really good, that we found out really good information on research. And so he kind of introduced me and took me up, and I went up the chain of the Republican Party. We were at the highest levels of what was going on in the Washington State Republican Party. What I saw there disgusted me. Revolted me. At a certain point, you cannot be a person of principle and be in the Republican Party. It's impossible. So for anyone to say they're on the fence, dude, your party put in Donald Trump. What you on the fence about? We had Daryl Castle and you had Donald Trump. What are you on the fence about? If you can't figure that out, don't come talk to me about liking you and all that other stuff. I don't have time for you. That's how we are. So having said that, I'm going to skip some things. Kind of move ahead. So, the other thing I want to tell him is, you might have looked at us and said, hey, these guys are nothing. That's about to change. He can do one of two things. He can either A, join the Constitution Party because you're going to be with the winners, or B, go back to the Republicans and tell them we're coming after them. So, as you look, and this is where we are standing right now, and in saying this, I want to clarify first right off the bat, has nothing to do with our leadership, our candidates, or anything like that. It's just the way things are. But when it comes to political influence, when it comes to our ability to make changes within the political world of the United States, that is them, and this is us. Now, can you see us? Can you see the dot?
No.
That's really good, because if you did, you need to clean your glasses. There isn't one there. We are, by a national standard, you can have nice good luck on local levels and whatnot, but as a national level, we are what's considered politically invisible. It's like if we didn't exist. That's how we are right now. And we got to change that. And I am going to tell you why we are this way. And that's because it is a rigged game. No, you don't even know how bad it's rigged. Here is how bad it rigged is. Let's assume that in the political world, we are the New England Patriots. And no, I am not a fan. I'm a Seahawk fan. We are not going to talk about that Super Bowl. We are not going to talk about that Super Bowl. But the New England Patriots are a good football team. If you were the New England Patriots, you would feel good about your chances of playing and winning. You're always in the, you know, you've gone to the Super Bowl a couple of times. You're always in the playoffs. You lead your league. You feel very good. That is us. We are a good party. We are a great party. We are probably the best when it comes to political parties being out there. We could feel good. So what we've done is we've gone to the Democrats and the Republicans, and we say, hey, we're pretty good. We think we can take you on. And they go, oh, great. Let's do it. But, sorry, the game's baseball, not football. We're not going to play your game. You're going to play our game. But, here's the problem. See, we're not even a good baseball team, and we know that. So we're going to change it up a little bit more. Guess what? You are going to play at our stadium each and every game in front of our home team. But we're not even sure we can win with that. So the umpires happen to be paid staff. Oh, they'll give you a fair game. We'll make sure they give you a fair game, but just understand they're under our employ. But we're not even confident we can win with that. So the commissioner is the owner of the team. So if you guys are winning, we might do some mid-game changes of the rules.
Yeah.
That is how rigged it is. And I'm using this as an analogy, but it is absolutely true. If you go in and if you play their game, if you act like a typical political party and do the things they do and do the things that they want you to do, what you are basically saying is, yeah, that's cool. We like those rules. So don't be surprised when you get your butt kicked every time. You're playing their game, you're playing right into their hands. They're making all the rules. So we have to get unconventional. We have to. We have to come in and tell them the game is football. And we're going to introduce your pitcher to our 300-pound defensive end. When we do that, we change the whole game. What I'm going to talk to you today is about how we can do that. So, what I have done is I've done some research for the Constitution Party. This kind of started, it was really funny. It kind of started off as just some demographic stuff that I was doing for the state guys. And it turned into something more, a whole lot more. And I found out a lot of information. So what I do want to tell you is we have one secret weapon. It's a very powerful weapon. You want to know what that secret weapon is?
Yeah.
Somebody was listening to me yesterday. God is on our side. So I am about to tell you some things that I want you to understand and be to get you very confident about what's going to happen. God is working to make us successful. We are about, you guys do not realize this. You're looking at this and you're going, we're this little tiny nothing out there and we can't get anything done. But what you don't know is things have been going on. This is the way he works, right?
Yep.
So there's a lot of things. He has been doing some things that have been happening that is positioning us to take and become the prominent party in the United States. But we have to do our part. We have to do some things with that. I'm also going to take this opportunity to say that he has been doing some things on the outside, and he has been doing some things on the inside. I have heard some things about our current leadership, and especially with Frank, and I'm going to tell you right now, we have the most perfect guy leading our party right now. We have to change, and to be changed, you have to be humble. Why does God want us to be humble? Why is he looking at that? He's not looking at us to be all submitting to him. He doesn't need that. He doesn't have no ego. He wants us to be humble because to change, you have to be humble. You have to recognize you need to change. I am here because we have a humble leader that understands that, hey, you know what? Maybe I'm not doing all the things that we could be doing, should be doing. Maybe we're not doing this right. Let's bring in some outside voices so that we can become better. Now, a difference between a non-believer and a Christian is a non-believer sees 4,000 coincidences and says, man, that's how the world was made. We see the hand of God. They see a lot of coincidence with a bunch of people from different backgrounds coming together in Philadelphia in 1776 with some ideas that formed a new nation. And they go, wow, that's really coincidental. And we go, no, that's the hand of God. You're looking at it now. Here's the big one. There's a phenomenon called a political population shift. It's not new. It has happened quite often in the world. With these things, and this is something that the other parties kind of are guessing, they're looking, they're seeing something, but they don't know. We are the only party that knows this. This is what's going on. So this political population shift happens all the time. It's gone through history a lot. And in every time, there's two things that always happens. Here's what happens. You get a power base that comes into play. They're the government. They're in power. They're taking over, whether king's government or whatever. These are the folks in power. They get arrogant. They get corrupt. They start doing things that disenfranchise the citizens that they are in control of or that they are leading. And what happens is they're right here, and the population goes, whoop, we're over here now. We don't believe in you. We don't like you. We don't want you. Two things happen 100% of the time. This has been repeated over and over and over again. Every time, two things happen. First thing that happens is the people in power refuse to move. They keep saying, come back. They use force. They use cajoling. They try whatever they want to do, but they don't move. They don't shift. They don't change their policies. They don't change the things that would make them back in line with the population. They just simply, you got to come back. And nobody does. Here's the killer part. The second thing that happens is everyone that took power from that point on was an obscure, unknown, non-playing entity. You see the names that I got up there? Every one of those people that came in, good or bad, had nothing to play with it. Some of them turned out very, very well. Some of them turned out to be very, very evil. And those are just a small list of what happened. But in every case, it started off that nobody knew who these guys were. They come in, they resonate with the new population shift, and they take power. There are some characteristics of these groups. What problem is, history says they came in and they convinced the people to go with them. It was just the opposite.
Right.
They changed their story to resonate with the new stuff. Most of these organizations and people up here changed their story because they wanted to resonate. And as soon as they resonate, boom, you're in power. The other guys are gone. 100% of the time. So you have to understand that this is what is going on. It is happening in the United States right now. There are literally thousands of indicators that the power base has stayed here, the population has shifted. This window will not stay open forever. In fact, it closes very, very quickly. The first person that reaches the mark wins. You were told a little bit earlier by Clint, who did a really good job of pointing out some people who are trying to hit that mark. You want to do this? You want to be there? We've got to do some stuff. And it's going to be hard. So make up your mind, what do you want to do it? I'm going to also point out some other things that can impact this. The other thing that God is helping us out with is millennials. Do not believe the hype, please. They are the future. Remember when we were young, all us gray hairs? Our parents didn't think much of us. They thought the world was going to be doomed when we took over. You're doing the same. Millennials should have been ignored because they were young. They were starting their families. They were in college. They did not care. But guess what? They're turning 30. They're turning 35. They're turning 40. They're becoming politically aware. And they do not like what they see. I'll tell you something. How we look at the millennials, let me tell you how the millennials look at us. They think we're idiots. Here's what they know. They know that during the time that they have become adults, in their time period, we elected a Democrat who turned out to be garbage. We elected a Republican who turned out to be bad. We elected hope and change, which turned out to be bad. And now we got this other... whatever, in office. Here's how they see it. We go to a trough of manure. We go, oh, it stinks. Oh, that was terrible. Back and over and over and over again. They think that's idiotic. Now, what they've done is said, hey, guys, we're opting out. That's not the right thing to do, but they're young. But they just said, you're stupid. You keep going back there and electing these idiots. We're opting out. We're done. We're going to go off and do other things. But to say that they're not politically aware, to say that they're not relevant, to say and dismiss them would be the greatest mistake, because whoever gets the millennials will get the politics for the next 20 years. They are going to be the president of 2024. It's going to be a millennial. We got to get them on board. But to do so, Clint did an awesome job. So right now, starting to say this, whatever he told you, I back up 200%. We have to communicate to them. I don't care the way you want to communicate. If they do things by Twitter, we do it by Twitter. If they don't like to talk to each other in person and they just want to chat and text and all that other stuff, okay, get over it. Let's do it. It's not their job to come to us. It's our job to come to them. And when we get them, we will have the largest voting block in 2020. The largest voting block in 2020. And I'm telling you, the libertarians, one of the things that has happened before I came here, I was being a political strategist for the libertarians. I left because you can't work with anarchists.
Exactly.
I will also tell you this. You need to know this. The largest growth in the Libertarian Party is coming from disenfranchised Republicans. And a lot of them are Christian conservatives. The reason why they're there and not here is because they don't see us as a viable source, and they see them as such. They're trying to change the libertarians to quit them to be anarchists. I don't think they're going to be successful. But there's a large group of libertarians out there waiting for someone to show up and tell them they got a new home. There's a large, and we don't even have to talk about the Republicans. They're self-destructing. We can see it before our very own eyes. Again, take a look at what God's handing you. He's handing you a political shift, and with the one party that could probably do something, they decided to self-destruct at the exact same time. Coincidence, huh? But we want to go after these guys. Don't believe the hype on these guys. Now, what the hype tells you is that these are all brainwashed liberals. What the research and data says is they actually divide up just like the rest of the country. And here's how the rest of the country looks. What's the big number up there?
38.
Who is it?
Conservative.
The only thing between millennials and us is there's a 2% higher increase for the liberals. There's 2% more liberals than us and 2% less conservatives. So we're actually 36-26 for them. Do you think we got an advantage?
Yes.
Okay. Now ignore those numbers. Because here's the real numbers. Republicans and Democrats go pretty much, they always, because the last five or six elections have kind of gone this way, they think it's 48-48, and you fight over the 4%. The Republican way of getting that 4% was to go more liberal. The Democrat way to get that 4% was to go more Hollywood. That's a joke. Come on. Wake up. But the reality of it is if you see this breakdown, it's a little more complex than what they think, and it's a little more complicated. The thing you have to understand is those groups on the top and the bottom, the strong and moderate liberal and the strong and moderate conservative, they will always vote straight lines. You are not going to move them very much. Moderates have very, very seldom switched. They will. The strong have never switched. Most of you in this room would be considered a strong conservative. Have you ever thought of voting for a Democrat or a liberal? It's not going to happen. The fight is always between these independents. Now let me show you something else. Take that number of conservatives. The independent conservative and the independent liberal, all things being equal, will vote straight conscious, straight conservative, straight liberal. They have made big switches. I'll give you two examples. The liberals came over, the independent liberal came over really big for Ronald Reagan. They were called the Reagan Democrats. They came over in droves. The independent Republican came out for Obama's first run, not his second one, but his first one. A lot of the independent Republicans came over for Obama. I think it was because of white guilt that they were feeling that. But if you had a message that all you did was resonate with the conservatives, get them all lined up, let's get them all together and let's all work at them, have a message that resonates with all conservatives, how much do you have? How much does it take to win election? So we can tell the liberals, go jump off a cliff, we don't need you anymore. We're not going to placate you, we don't want to talk to you, go away. We don't need you. Just that alone. Now I can almost guarantee you that if you can hit the independent conservative, you can hit the independents. They go back and forth. They're doing that. But remember, they're part of that population shift too. They are very much a part of that. They have the same issues that everyone else has. So you're coming in there, and if you can bring them along, you're going to have quite a bit of a majority. So what is stopping us? Actually, I did this already. So think of what's stopping you. We're going to play Family Feud. I've already done the research for you. I've gone out and talk to Constitution Party people, ask them what they are, and this is what the survey is. Top one is the top answer, and goes on forth. What did you say? So if you said the media, you were right up there with the top answer from everyone. Oh, the media is against us. They hate us. And then with the two parties, lack of monies. I love the conspiracy ones. I really, really, really do. I'm not a conspiracist. I really am. I'm not. But I love that one. Anyways, that's what we think. Now, that is the most dangerous thing we can do. Stop it. Now. It's dangerous for two reasons. Number one, do we control any of those?
No.
How it's going to change them?
No.
We can't change them. You've just taken our power away. It's impossible. If they are responsible for keeping us down, there's nothing we can do. And this is where it really gets dangerous. Clint brought it up again a little bit, but I'm going to reinforce it and tell you what it really means. In this party, I have noticed a culture of defeatism. It shows its ugly face in so many. We never come out and say, we can't win. We don't do that. But what we don't do is we don't get things done. Our leaders lead. We start fighting among each other. We start using these pointing fingers of, well, he doesn't believe the way I believe, so I don't like him. We see things not getting accomplished. We see websites that are up that should have been gone and changed a long time ago. We see things not getting done. That is a culture of defeatism. It'll kill us. So what we're going to do right now, today, if anything else, leave with this. We will control our own destiny. We don't need them. He just showed you a way that you can bypass the media, bypass the parties. We go direct to the people. Forget them. They're not worthy of us. We're going to take control of our own destiny. Now, to do that, here comes the hard part. Why do we do this? Because it's easy to do this. Their fault, their fault, their fault, their fault. Once we take control of our destiny, we got to do this. Uh-oh. It's our fault. And we don't want to do that. That comes from both leaders and just the members alone. We don't want to do that. Again, pointing back to Frank. He's a man that said, you know what, I'm willing to point the finger at. Let's do that. This is what God wants us to do. This is what we have to do. We have to be humble and say, maybe there's a different way. I am going to present to you a different way, but it doesn't have to be the only way. This is just my idea to go. The big thing is we have to sit there and say, we cannot be doing the things we've been doing for the last 14 years and expect different results. That's insanity, isn't it? There ain't no crazy people here.
Well.
Yeah, I'll except it'd be me too. So, here's another clue for you. If you use this in your political thinkings as a candidate, as a party leader or whatnot, you're going to be way ahead of the game. When you go in to vote, when you go in to decide, you're making a decision about joining a political party. When you do that, you are making an emotional decision. It has been proven, researched, looked at 1,000 times, and it happens every time. The part of your brain active in the voting booth is the emotional side of your brain, not logic and reasoning. Throwing data, information, and facts at people do not work. You have to approach them from an emotional side. Here's what happens. You make an emotional decision. I am voting for candidate A because something emotionally in me, doesn't have to be positive or negative, it just has a motivation of emotional sense, makes it. Then what happens is you use logic and reason to justify your decision. You reject all that logic and reason that doesn't, that's going contrary to your decision. You accept all the logic and reason that makes sense. That's how come liberals can justify what they do. We all look at that and go, you guys are crazy. How come you're doing that? They made an emotional decision, and then they take all these stupid facts and justify it. So we have to reach out to them emotionally if we want to get them. What is the number one emotion that people feel? Outside, what I did is I looked at outside the Constitution Party. We got lots of social media stuff. Boy, do we get a lot. Thank you. That group over there, they're doing too much. Made my work hard. Outside, what does our enemy say about us? I'm a big believer in Sun Tzu Art of War, which is unconventional tactics. One of the things he says is, know your enemy, know yourself, 1,000 battles, 1,000 victories. We have to know what our enemy is saying about us. So I looked at it at that.
Well, our enemies say that we're racist, misogynistic, Islamophobic, xenophobic, several other kind of things.
Anti-Semitic.
Yeah.
Anti-Jewish.
I'm going to tell you guys right now, the more I listen to Daryl, the more I like him. He's not loud like a lot of politicians. He's not boisterous like a lot of talk. He's one of those, just those eloquent southern statesmen. He may not be loud, but what he says is very poignant. He said two things so far that just really gave me, that was one of them. He's really touched what the problem is. The other one is, we have to realize that this is not the same world that the Founding Fathers had. It's a different world. Face it. Don't fight it. Face it. Let's get these people on board, then we'll make it the world that we want to make it. But we can't sit there and say, you're wrong. We're right. We have to go and bring them in and then do what Jesus taught us to do, was through love, through patience, through understanding, then bring them and make them what we want. So, the number one emotion that we feel, that people feel, when they are thinking about the Constitution Party is fear. Basically what Daryl said, they're afraid we're racist. The most biggest fear that comes up often more, like bam, 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 all the time, is the Constitution Party is going to create a theocracy. Now, I'm going to stop this right here because you have to understand this. I know this has been brought up several times before, and I'm not going to bring it up now. It has nothing to do with the things that we say about Jesus and about God in the Bible. It is how we say it. So I am not saying that we take all that stuff out. I am saying that a theocracy is bad, and we all know that. There's nobody in this room. I've never talked to a Constitution Party that said, yes, we want to create a theocracy. We know that. The same guiding hand of God that brought in this nation into being said the first thing out of the box was freedom of religion, because that's God's way. That's the Christian way. We are not the Taliban. You come to Jesus by your own free will. So we're not. But why do they think we are? It's because of how we are saying it that makes them think that. So what I'm going to tell you is we can keep it. But just understand that if you do, you have to work very, very hard to make sure we clarify what our position is. We have to assure them that we do not want to create theocracy. We have to make sure that they understand what we understand. The big thing for us is the way we perceive ourselves has to be the way that others perceive us. Because perception is reality. And what's happened is we've been in a bubble and we've been talking to each other and we didn't realize they're listening. Both our enemies and the investigating people. And we say things with the knowing that the other guy on the other end understands us, not realizing that someone else out there listening and they're seeing this and they're going, wow, these guys are really far right. Oh yeah, I can do this one. This one I love. Oh, here's my good one. Southern Poverty Law Center. The Constitution Party is the most extreme far right party in the U.S. Extremists scare people. Now, Southern Poverty Law Center.
Yeah.
Well, but here's the thing. If there was ever a group of frothing extremists, that's them. So if it takes one to know one, then obviously we're extremists. We don't want to be extremists. We don't have to be extremists. Conservatism isn't an extremism. It's really not. We believe in a lot of things that people would consider libertarian, which is, you know what, I'm not going to force you to do anything. So, but the word extremist gets people afraid. The fear that they have is not the, kind of fear. It's that I'm looking at them and, you know what, no, I'm going to stick with the Republicans because these guys are just a little scary. That's all it takes. So we got to do something to take care of this.
Can you read the second point, the second?
See, the way your computer is set up, it's cutting out the...
Yeah, it really doesn't matter. The second one is the Constitution Party takes strong conservative stance on a variety of issues. The party's preamble is the 2000 National Platform. The reason why I put that up there, guess what they used? Our words, our platform, to reach a wrong conclusion. Using the American political system with a strongly religious bent. Innocent words, but when you're looking at it from the outside, you see strongly religious, strongly conservative, and you think wackos. We've got to change this, and we've got to change it with our own words. Part of this issue comes from hidden agendas, and we are tagged with it. We don't have hidden agendas. But Democrats have hidden agendas, Republicans have hidden agendas. Acorn has a hidden agenda. Everybody assumes that if you are the news media has a hidden agenda. Everybody assumes that if you're associated with politics, you must have a hidden agenda. Ours is we're going to create a theocracy. That's our hidden agenda. They think we're sitting here right now lobbying the overthrow of the government so that we can establish, you know, the Pope as president or something. I don't know. But you have to accept that. Until we can change their minds, they're going to think that we have some hidden agenda that we really don't have. So this is what it translates to. White only, Christian only, heterosexual only, and extreme conservative only. That's the only people who can join this party. That's the only people who can be a party. Does anyone in this room agree with that? Nobody does. Here's the problem with that. It translates to that they're racist, you want to be a Christian theocracy, that they're homophobic, and we're going to pass these huge, crazy, extremist conservative laws. So, here's where things come together. I did the research, and I looked at, because of this whole political shift thing, I said, okay, so the party that resonated with the political shift was the party that won. What is the message of the political shift? And what I found out is this exact same message resonates with the millennials, and this exact same message is what combines all the conservatives. So three things pop out. All you got to do is those three things. You're going to do the shift, the millennials, and the conservatives, and get it all together. What they are saying and what they're looking at is they want a morally honest and non-corrupt politician. They are sick and tired of corrupt Washington, of corrupt cities, of corruption all over the place. They're done. They are so done. And, again, the entrenchment comes into place. What happens? Look at Hillary. Look, she is such a perfect example of what's wrong. She was like, yeah, I did it, now try to catch me. She didn't even hide it. They don't anymore. They're coming right out and saying, yeah, we're corrupt. What are you going to do about it? The other guys are too. And the American people have said, we're done. We are so done. Okay, name me a party that is talking about having morally and honest, upstanding politicians to be part of that. Who was the one that put out in the field a morally principled candidate? Oh, and guess what? We just struck number one. That's actually the biggest one, too. You can almost take the other two off and get away with it. They are so tired. They are so tired of this. But the second one is a fiscally responsible government. Now, the independent conservatives, they go liberal and they go conservative and whatnot, and they go back and forth. The disagreement between them and the Republicans is not a fiscally conservative government. Here's where they come from. We want social programs. They do not like the word limited government. Let's get rid of that term. I'll show you what we're going to come up with. Limited governments means we're going to cut social programs. And they are saying, look, we want to feed the hungry. We're not callous. We don't want mothers starving and babies dying. We want to feed people. We want to put them in housing. But here's the problem. We're watching the government spend money on this, and we're not happy. Nobody likes giving a plumber $1,000 and then him telling you, hey, you still got leaks. I fixed it, but it's still leaking. We get ticked at that. No, fix the stupid thing. I just paid you to do it. They're not doing it. So what the independent conservatives are saying is, look, we want to do these things, but we just think the government needs to be better at it and spending it. So they're looking for a fiscally responsible government. The last thing is, they are tired of bad economies. It is getting them down. It is suppressing people. We are tired of having all these jobs out there. Immigration is not an issue of immigrants. Immigration is an issue that they're stealing my jobs. What if we had an economy that was so big, so great, so massive, that we said, guess what? We have to loosen our immigration standards, not as far as security, but right now we're trying to keep people out. What if we said we got to start getting more people in because we do not have enough people to fill all the jobs we have? Isn't that a different kind of immigration problem? What if we build an economy that was so massive, so great, so big, that you get out of high school without a college education, you have 10 jobs offered. You get a college degree, you got 20 jobs. What if it that if you start a business instead of every, 90% fail in 3 years? What if it was the opposite? What if there was a 90% chance that you start a small business, it would succeed? So your business succeeds, you get bigger, and then you start hiring people, and it gets really great. What if we told people that we're not going to go through these cycles of up and down, up and down, up and down. You have a job, you don't have a job, you have a job, but we're going to just keep it up there all the time. What kind of message would that? In a time of pessimism, in a time of despair, we are going to be talking about hope, real hope. We're going to be the most optimistic party out there by saying this, by telling them that you can have all the jobs you want. Let me give you another clue. Corporations do not like capitalism. Get that out of your head. That's a Republican lie. They love socialism. Why is Jeff Bezos and Amazon contributing a ton of money to the Democratic Party? Because here's the thing about a large corporation. I can deal with the government. They tax me and I don't like it, but I can deal with them. What I fear is a small business with a good idea that's better than mine. Because he kicks me out. Capitalism at its best, when it's running the way it's supposed to run, the small business takes out the large corporation, knocks them out, just like the cell phone did away with the regular phone, just like the internet took out the phone book. Destructive technology, we call it. That's capitalism. It takes out the big guy, he in turn becomes the big guy, and another little guy comes up to take him out. Competition. That's what makes it work. That's what makes it great. Large corporations hate competition. So they get the government to do their dirty work for them. So we are going to be talking about small businesses. A great economy built on small businesses.
What is that first word before business?
Pro-business. So if we do all these things and we get all the conservatives plus just 10% of the moderates, we get a 61%. 61% is just not 11% over the average. In politics, 61% is a landslide victory. You get a candidate who does 61%, you have arrived. You are relevant. You are making people will stand up and notice you. They will go there and go, whoa, what just happened here? You will make a big difference. You'll know when you're alive when they start attacking you really bad. So, my proposal, and it's just mine, is that we restructure our messaging using the tools that we were just told about and the tools we are going to be told about. We're going to restructure our message. We're going to have three simple things. And the reason for that, in marketing, when you go out in sales, if you have a business, you do not go out there and say, okay, on your website, you don't put up, here are 10,000 things that we do. Take a look at them. They're all over. We got pictures, things flying around, da-da-da-da. In marketing, we have found that you do three things. Three things can be easily retained. Three things are easy to remember, and you're going to absorb it. So what we're going to do is we're going to just talk about three things over and over and over again. Pound, 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 pound. Here's the goal. If I walk out on the street and I grab a person and I say, what do you know about the Constitution Party? He better repeat one or all three of those things to me. So the first one. We're going to restore integrity, accountability, and honesty to politics. We're going to have to come up with solutions, a way to do that, but we're going to do that. We're going to make sure, as a party, our job is to make sure every one of our candidates are honorable, honest men, and if they're not, we're not going to take the route that the other parties do by trying to hide them, spin it, hide it, cover it up. We're going to throw them out. Get out of here. We don't want you. We're going to establish the trust between the people and the politicians, once again, to America. We're going to do that. The second one, government is the most ineffective, inefficient, and most expensive way of doing anything. We don't say limited government, we just say government's wrong. So I'm going to kind of go, I'm going to go off the board here. I'm going off the reservation. So Daryl. Last night, I'm sorry, Ricardo, pointed him out. Once again, did something for that. This is going to, you're going to like this. Last night, Daryl asked the judge about the Black Lives Matter and the responsibility for it. I'm going to show you how this relates to the second part here. Blacks are discriminated against. They are being held down by a racist white regime. They have been. In the 60s, there were two visions that was presented. We understood that there was a problem. There was a racist problem and we had to solve it. There were two visions that were given. One was by a preacher out of Selma. And he talked about white kids, black kids, Hispanic kids, Oriental kids, playing together in the neighborhood, living together in a community. You would have rich, middle class, and poor, but it would be even all the way around. That was his vision. They shot him. The other vision came from Lyndon B. Johnson. There is a phone recording where he was talking to one of his donors that was out there, a racist donor out there, that was afraid of the black vote. And he used the words, I'm paraphrasing, but it's there, you can read it. He said, don't worry, I got a plan to keep the neighbors segregated.
Oh.
Guess what? We adopted his plan. So we put them into these project homes, cesspool homes. We barely feed them. We take away their families. The institutions that were working, like the churches, we took them away. We destroyed the families. Darren, you talk about how we destroyed the cities overseas and in the Middle East. We learned how to do that in Watson, Harlem. We cut our teeth over there. That was your government plan. The one thing that is working right now in black communities are churches. I'll give you a really quick example. I was in the airport. And I saw this group there. They were going to the Bahamas for a marriage retreat. And it was absolutely, it was a black church. There was just all African Americans there. And I thought, wow, that's cool. We're going to the Bahamas. We're waiting. So I sat down and talked to them. I said, wow, that's a pretty good trip you guys are going on. And they told me what was going on. Their minister did more than give them spiritual nourishment. He also talked to them about building families, about keeping the marriage intact. He was telling the husbands, stay with your wife, raise your children. He told them to go get jobs. Do not depend upon welfare because you're going to starve. Go out and get good jobs and build strong families. And everyone in that church did that. They were all successful. They were all doing great. And we shouldn't be surprised that this shouldn't be something like we're going, oh, black people successful. That's one of them. That was Martin Luther King's vision. A black minister figured it out. The government has spent $14 trillion in 50 years, and what do we got? We've got people shooting each other like crazy because we put them in these terrible conditions, introduced them to drugs, gave them guns so that they can entertain us on the nightly news by shooting each other. Yes, black lives matter. Yes, they're being discriminated against. Now, looking at that, we come in with a message of, guess what? We like Martin Luther King's vision better. We're going to adopt that. We say that, I dare anyone to call us racist.
That's what I dare. Yes.
We'll agree with them. You are being held by white racists. They just happen to be called Democrats. Yeah, and Republicans. The last part of that message is we will create the greatest economy growth that the world, not the U.S., the world has seen. We will usher in the most wealth, the most innovation, the most jobs, and create growth for new businesses, the most new growth of businesses in American history. It will be called the greatest achievement in civilization. Once again, let me show you the hand of God. We are looking at a situation where global resources, through technology, through transportation, through abilities that we have, global resources are readily available, and global markets are readily available. What would happen if the United States was able to take these global resources, bring them into the United States, manufacture goods, and then export them to global markets? If we didn't have government writing these stupid, horrible treaties that benefited somebody else other than us, if we didn't have government killing businesses, if we simply adopted a capitalistic form of economy, we would see the biggest economic growth, because never before in history of the world has it been possible to do what we can do. And I guarantee you, if you did that, at least three people in this room that are making just barely middle income will be a multimillionaire, because that will be the average. It is such a great opportunity for us. We come in with that message. This is who we are. This is what we want. I'm going to guarantee you the emotion that is going to change when they think about the Constitution Party is going to be something different. Clinton did this. I'll just reiterate it. Forget them. Do not go to the media. They hate you. Do not kiss their ring and beg them to listen to you, to interview you, to talk to you. Forget them. We're going to go through the social media route. The internet is the Gutenberg press of today. The Gutenberg press in the 1600s launched the Renaissance, because what it did is it took information that was being controlled by the church state, not the church, the church state, that said, we will not allow you to see this stuff. The press said, here, everybody, read it. Before you know it, kings are being overthrown, liberties springing up all over the place. The internet and social media is that same thing. They don't control it. They want to, but they don't. We're going to fight to make sure that they don't. The second thing we're going to do is we're going to use it. We are going to be the free press. We're going to go out there. We're going to tell people our message. Let them resonate with us. Last thing that I want to talk about on those three messages, we will still have issues. If you want to have the issues, they're going to be there. But here's how it's going to work. If you say, how do you feel about abortion? How do you feel about immigration? How do you feel about this and about that? There will be a place for you to go. When you get there, we're not going to have this little one-liner that you can misinterpret. We're going to have enough information in there that you will know what we believe, why we believe it, how did we come to this conclusion, what are the things that we are concerned about. If it takes one page, fine. If it takes 20 pages, fine. But you're not leaving that side until you understand clearly what our position is. There will be no more misinterpretation. If somebody goes out there and tells a lie about us, about a policy, we're going to be able to go right back and say, they're lying. We can prove it. Because here's what it says. Then you answer that question, and you bring them right back to the three issues again. Okay, we answered your question. You're satisfied? Great. Now let me tell you about the good news. We're going to be the gospel of politics. The good news of politics. We just pound that back again, and we'll take them right back there. So, we're going to start by communicating, like I said. These are my ideas. There's better ideas out there. There's more ideas. There's lots of ideas out there. But we start by saying, let's do something different. Let's do something better. And we convince ourselves that we are going to do this. We can do this. We want to do this. God is on our side. There's no reason why we cannot be successful. We start thinking about our president in 2020, taking over Congress in 2020, taking over all the cities in 2020, taking over state legislatures. It's going to be hard work. It's going to take a little bit there. Do realize that it's hard to move the Titanic. You can't do it in one day. But what Clint told us today can have dramatically quick effects. I would not be surprised if things happen faster than that. They have that potential. You resonate, you hit the ship. Now, the Nazis were really, really horrible, but they came into power within 4 years because they resonated. We can do the same. I'm just saying. So there's tools are out there. It's just, do we have the will? Do we have the capability of doing that? So, self-promotion, this is not for me as far as making money. There's two things that I am doing. There is a political strategy proposal that I prepared up. I gave it to Frank to look at. It's more detailed. If you're interested, email me. I'll send it to you. It's not complete, but it's good. Or good enough, I should say. I created a website called Constitucionista. What that is a place to discuss political strategy. Now, if you're not interested in there, don't go there. What it's for is for candidates, leaders, people that want to be involved with shaping strategy. And it's a place for us to start talking. That right now, there is just some articles that I'm putting up that talk about strategy issues. But
Have trust in the system. The Chinese have been trying to shut down the internet for their people for a long time. I haven't been able to be very, they're moderately successful, but not much. People will find, the thing of it is, again, here we go. Secret weapon that God has given us. Born inside of every individual is a fire that burns for freedom. We are born naturally. You come hardwired. You resist oppression. Anybody that's ever had teenagers, 2-year-olds, what you're seeing is that natural resistance to tyranny. We do not want to be told what to do. When we grow up, we really resent that. Anywhere where there's tyranny and oppression, there will always be a resistance to it. And so they're going to fight that. Right now, there's little we can do, because I can tell you right now, the Democrats and the Republicans are all for it. They want to control the system. They do not want free information out. They want to control it through their medias. Whether it's Fox News or CNN or NBC, they don't care. They want to control it. Rush Limbaugh, Sean Hannity, those are not conservative tacos, guys. They're Republican mouthpiece. You're not going to get favorable results from them. I don't know about the other, but those two for sure, because they supported Donald Trump. If you supported him, you're not a conservative. But realize that they want to control because they're in power. If you're in power, you have to control it. So they're going to try to stop it. We've got time, though. It's going to be a hard job. By the time that they would be able to do it, I don't care what they do with the UN and all of that stuff. It's just, again, it's going to take time to do it. If we can get in power, we can stop it. Any other questions? Daryl.
I just have a comment, and that is that I'm all in on the question presented and the fact that the party has to change. Because for 25 years, let's face it, people haven't been willing to buy what they're selling, not in enough numbers. But it does concern me that we're going to have these people out there kind of turn loose on the internet. It seems to me that we should have some type of liaison between them and the platform. How that would work, I don't know. But
again, let's go to it. Let's do it. Let's talk about those details.
I actually echo what he's saying. And I'm thinking maybe a spokesman.
And trust me, guys, this is the tip of a very, very big iceberg. Mm-hmm. For everything that I told you, there's at least 1,000 actions that have to take place. Organizational, we got to get better organizations. Frank knows that, you know that, I know that. There's a lot of things in communication we have to improve. There's a lot of things in structure that we have to improve. That's why I'm saying, let's find a place to get together and start talking about them. Those who want, the doers and the shakers. If you're going to just sit on your butt and watch things happen, don't go there. We don't want you. If you believe that we can make changes and you want to be a part of that, let's get together and start talking about it. Let's start exchanging ideas. Let's start thinking about how is this going to happen. The great thing about the system of what we do is we are not this elitist, I've got all the answers type of people. We realize that the great brain trust is here, not here. So we're going to say, look, you guys got great ideas. Let's hear them. And because I've got all of you, they got themselves. They just got them. They have to believe in themselves. I got all of you to get great ideas about. We're going to be better at this. Any other questions? Oh, this way? Okay, well, I'll just leave it up there for just a second. Thank you very much. I want you to leave this meeting today, walk out of this room tonight, believing we're going to do this. We are, this is the day we become the power.
Faith without works is dead, folks.
Yes. Thank you very much.